All right, let's get started. So in the next 20 minutes, I will like to explain you a bit about the paper we published called Generic Programming in Space and Time. This is work done with my former advisor, Markus Püschel, former advisor because I recently graduated, and together in the collaboration with Thierry Rompf at Purdue University. And with this, let's dive right into it and start off with... Okay, better? All right, it's better? Okay. So let's dive right into it. Unfortunately, it's a bit small here, but I first want to give you an idea about the domain we're trying to solve a problem within, which is the domain of code generators, in particular code generators that use algorithmic knowledge within a very specialized domain together with the generator logic to produce an intermediate representation, which then we unparse into one of many backends that might be Scala, that might be C++, that might be even hardware generation. And what's particular in our use case compared to many of the related work is that we don't have a whole DSL as an input, but we usually focus on a single domain. And our input is just a spec, like for example, for a discrete Fourier transform, it's the input size or the data format we want to use or how we want to store complex numbers. Whereas for example, in filters, it might be the symmetry of the filter, the size of the filter and so on. So it's very limited input spec. And throughout the rest of the talk, I will refer to everything that surrounds a code generator as the meta stage and everything that is that deals with the output, the generated code, I refer as the target stage. And the problem we are trying to solve is that in our experience, the code generators tend to be very large and they tend to become very large. This is partially due to, well, let's say just bad programming practice that happens in the field of high performance computation, like that people just have ad hoc scripts and so on. And of course, one could solve that with just standard software engineering techniques. But there's also a particular code duplication that happens only in this field, which I want to illustrate on our case study, namely the discrete Fourier transform, or more concretely, an algorithm of the discrete Fourier transform, the FFT, the fast Fourier transform, where you have algorithmic knowledge, namely that you can decompose a DFT of size n into smaller DFTs of size k and m. And now what's particular about this is that depending on the knowledge you have while generating code, the application of the algorithmic knowledge vastly differs. So in the case where you have knowledge of the size of the DFT, you can actually apply this rule already during code generation and as such can fully decompose the recursion during code generation and specialize on the size. If, on the other hand, you don't know the input size n, you will actually have to delay the divide and conquer decomposition to the target code, and as such also need to implement all the infrastructure to do so in the generated code. And this is a problem because we apply the same knowledge twice, but the issue is that the meta phase and the target phase might be two completely separate languages. So in our case, the meta phase is Scala, and the target phase could be anything like C++ and so forth. And what usually happens is that you then start to duplicate logic across these two stages. And the underlying research question that we had that led up to this paper was, can we utilize state-of-the-art programming, better programming techniques and programming languages to build code generators more efficiently? And what we tried to solve with this question is three major challenges. Namely, we want to abstract over various degrees of specialization. So for example, in this simple function, we might want to go over the whole range from fully specialized to unspecialized, meaning that either we know the inputs ahead of time and therefore at code generation time, we can fully pre-compute the result. We might only partially know the input, or we might not know the input at all, which is the unspecialized case and where we basically reflect the original computation. And our goal is to actually be able to abstract over all this space. Similarly, we might want to abstract over functions. So imagine that now for the simple function, we not only want to do partial specialization on the body of the function, but we actually want to generate code for the specialized function in the target, meaning that now we need different function signatures for each of these variants. So where we know both inputs ahead of time, of course, we don't need any parameter, whereas in the unspecialized case, we need both original parameter in the generated code. And finally, something that happens as a requirement as well is that sometimes we need to cross phases. We sometimes need to go from the meta phase to the target phase and vice versa. This might sound a bit weird now, but if I give you two examples, I think it's clear. An example of going from the meta phase, from the code generator to the target phase, would be unrolling. So if you have a loop where you know the loop bound, you could, of course, pre-compute, so unroll the loop during code generation. But sometimes that's just not a good idea for performance reasons, because the loop unrolling becomes too big, and it actually hinders your performance. So you actually might want to delay the evaluation of the loop to the target phase, so that loop would be going from meta phase to the target phase. The reverse case happens in the case of base cases, which is very common in any kind of divide and conquer algorithm, where at some point you want to drop into a base case, and that's usually done a runtime check on the size, for example, where after the runtime check, you can actually drop into a size specialized variant of the code, which basically you do, you know, statically this size we know, therefore we can drop into that. And this would be this way around. So to illustrate this on our running example, the FFT, I want to first highlight that the codes are really, really different. So if you know the input size, in the case of the general size code, you have still all sorts of control flow in there, like conditionals, loops, recursive calls. You have computation that depends on the input size and so forth. Whereas in the specialized code, where you know the input size, you can then fully unroll all the loops, you can inline all the functions, you can pre-compute all values that depend on the input size. And that allows you to give you this straightforward straight line code. And this is very relevant because, for example, for size 16, the IR that you would get for this type of specialized code is only composed of simple arithmetic expressions, so mults and adds. And if you were to unparse this to C, the type of code you would get is this really ugly straight line code that gives you very good performance. So every high performance library for in this case, the fast food transform will have this kind of code because this will yield you performance. And in this domain, this type of code is usually referred to as a codelet. Okay, but coming back to the general size FFT, also there you actually want to do better in terms of performance than just the straightforward implementation. What you do and what you'll do in general in most divide and conquer algorithms is that you actually don't recurse all the way down to the very base case, but you stop the recursion earlier. So in this case, for example, we decided to stop the recursion at size 64 and then drop into a size specialized variant. And you do this because most of the work is actually done in the leaf of the recursion, and dropping into size specialized variants gives you a lot of performance. So what you actually need to do is to mix size specialized variants with the general infrastructure. And here that might look like very trivial, but I just want to give you an idea. This is a call graph of a real FFT, and the things here in blue are codelets, so the size specialized variants, and the things in the boxes in green are the library infrastructure. And the reason there are so many here, and I want to point out each of them is a unique function in terms of its signature. The reason there are so many here is because not only do you specialize on the size in the case of the DFT, but you specialize on input strides, output strides, scaling factors, and many more parameters, which you have to do if you want to get the full performance. And that's why these graphs become so complex, and that's also why the FFT is such a prime example for the technique that I will introduce in a bit. Okay, so you see on the use case of the FFT already that we have all our challenges here. We need to specialize different degrees of specialization. We need to specialize functions for the call graph in the case of the general size FFT, and we need to mix specialization, meaning dropping into size specialized variants within the general size FFT to get good performance. And just to give you an idea how the landscape in general looks like in this domain, I will compare a lot to JTransform, which is just a straight hand-coded, purely Java-based library. And one library that you for sure or hopefully heard of already is FFTW, which particularly got famous around 2000 for being one of the first to actually auto-generate the codelets. Then the work of my former advisor, for which I think he's most known for, Spiral, got famous for also not only auto-generating the codelets, but also generating the library infrastructure. And what's the point also is that this is exactly the kind of code duplication that I talked about earlier, namely the fact that it was two generators that one had to glue together manually. And the big achievement of this work is that we actually managed to write a single generator that in a single pass is able to generate both fixed size and library structure code in one go, and it's one abstract generator. Also worth pointing out is the size. This is a bit of an apples and oranges comparison, I have to admit, because of course they differ vastly in their capabilities. But I think it's still worth pointing out that we managed to encode the core logic of the FFT in 200 lines, and the whole generator is only 1,200 lines of Scala. So I think that's worth pointing out. And before I dive now into the technicalities, I want to point out that also in terms of performance, we are in the same ballpark than our competitors. We didn't really dive too deep into this because that's a lot of low-level optimizations, and the point of this work was more the abstractions and making the program generator very concise. Okay, and with this, I now dive into the actually how did we manage to do this? How did we manage to get this code generator so small? So we used lightweight modular staging, and given that it's this conference, I'm sure everyone heard already about it. It's a staging framework in the spirit of the previous talk. The major difference to other staging frameworks is that it uses types to distinguish the stages. So on the left-hand side, that's just a regular Scala program that executes as you would expect from Scala. And on the right-hand side, this is where you use staging annotations. So staging annotations are just a high-order type that you use to annotate that what you store in these variables are actually IR node identifiers. And whenever you perform a computation using those identifiers, instead of actually performing, in this case, an integer computation, you will actually create an IR node that represents the computation and return its identifier as a result. And to sum up for this talk, what you only need to know is that a type T represents execute now, and a type rep of T represents executed later, so create a symbolic representation of it. And anything of type T is part of the generator or the meta time, and anything of type rep of T is part of the generated code or the target time. And in this framework, it's trivially possible to go from T to rep of T because something that is dynamic at code generation time can always become a constant in the generated code. So this already solves half of our third challenge. And how do we apply this to our case study? So you don't need to read the code. Just believe me, this is a FFT implementation, roughly. And in here, we have a case class that represents complex numbers with the real and imaginary part as doubles. And if you now just annotate here that it's actually not doubles, but stage doubles, what will happen is that all operations that are performed on those doubles will be executed symbolically, and while executing this code will actually create us an IR that represents the computation. So if we were to execute this code with input size 16, what we will actually get is an IR representing the computation for size 16. And it's exactly the type of code I showed you before, so that's no coincidence. This was actually generated with this type of code that is fully unrolled, and this codelet type of code that yields very good performance. And the key insight that underlies the whole paper is that we realized that all we changed between the two implementations is the type here. It's a small change here where one gives you a Scala FFT function, just a regular Scala FFT function, and the other gives you a codelet. And since it's just types, and that's a big difference to the previous talk, for example, we can actually use all the machinery that is available for abstracting over types, so generic programming machinery, such that we can say, actually, we only write one implementation that can do both. So we can actually abstract over this. And This is really the key insight that the whole paper builds upon, where we realized that in regular generic programming, you might want to abstract over, for example, in this case, whether you do the squaring of integers in float. And in Scala, you would, for example, then write one abstract version, a generic version that uses a type class numeric that tells this type T just needs to have a multiply. And as long as it has the multiply method, I can happily abstract over this. And we realized we actually called this staging in time, in space. And that's opposed to staging in time, where now that we can say that the staging decision is also only a difference in type, we can use exactly the same trick. We use just vanilla Scala type machinery that we use a type class again that now allows us to either use an integer or a staged integer. And we can write one version that can do both. So either it executes now or it executes later. And the nice thing is this is nicely composable with just a regular generic programming. So that's hence the title, generic programming in space and time. We can write one version that can abstract both over the data type that we want to use, but also over the stage we want to use it in. And we really track that idea to the max. I will very quickly just skim over this, but the takeaway is really like you can abstract, using this, you can abstract over many transformations that usually you would use for high performance computations. So for example, unrolling a loop is nothing more than executing the loop now or executing the loop later. Same thing for any type of pre-computation, and also inlining is just, do you apply the function now or do you apply it later? And that already solves our first challenge where we want to abstract, write a function that covers this whole space of specialization where we now use type classes to represent that our parameter here can now be either a regular value or a staged value. And using this, we can now describe the whole space of specialization by just passing the according type. If we pass in just regular types, it is fully specialized. If we pass in staged types, it's unspecialized. And second challenge, I have to make a small detour, namely the fact I need to quickly explain that we use a lot of what we call metacontainers in our work, meaning just objects that we use to structure our code. So in this case, we actually want to, in our target code, only deal with doubles. But to make our life easier in the generator, we have a class complex around it. And the nice thing about this is that in the generic code, you won't see the meta time container, this class here. And we can, in the generator, then use just regular functions to work with this, which is fine. But the problem is once we want to generate code, we need to transform this first because this complex class doesn't have a staging annotation, therefore cannot appear in the generated code. And what we actually need to do is decompose it always before. So we always need to first desugar this complex into its components, its two doubles. And this became a very cumbersome task to do this over and over and over in our code. So we introduced yet another type class that you don't need to read all this code, but basically it describes the isomorphism between the container and its components. How do we compose and decompose a container from its components? And the cool thing about this is that as a consequence of this, we can now describe something like this. We can at code generation time talk about, for example, a vector of complex, where the complex has the staged values. And a vector, of course, has a dynamic property, namely its length. And by instrumenting the type class with these dynamic properties, we say that once we generate code, we use this length to actually tell during code generation time how many components is this vector of complex now composed of. And long story short, this allows us to write, for example, arbitrary RET functions. We just, in the code generator, we go from vector of complex to vector of complex. And when we generate code, it's then any RET that this vector actually has during code generation time. Unfortunately, I cannot go into the details of this. And if anyone is interested, I'm very happy to discuss this offline. But I just want to get the key idea across that we use these meta containers to now basically abstract over the parameter list. So we say, OK, I have a parameter list that is encapsulated within this class. And what this class does for me is that it says, OK, I have, in this case, a parameter A and B. And it might be static. I might be dynamic. And the actual decision, which one of the two it is given for type class that will then tell me like, look, it's all static or it's all dynamic or it's a mix of the two. And what this allows me is to now create these call graphs that I showed you earlier already, because we recurse into ourselves. And while we recurse, we adjust which parts are static, which parts are dynamic, and create appropriate functions. So this, for example, is a call graph for if we know the style statically, then we can recurse. And each of these functions is different because every time we specialize on the size. And in the DFT case, this is particularly powerful because even if we don't know the size, we can specialize on all sorts of things. So here, for example, the size is unknown, but we specialize on input strides, we specialize on scaling, and so forth. And finally, the last challenge, which is actually, I already spoiled it. So we can go from here to here. That's very trivial in LMS, in the staging framework. But going from here to here, we just need to use a simple trick. Namely, we do a runtime check. So if you have a value that is a dynamic value, so at something that is only known in the generated code, just by doing a runtime check, we know that inside the branch, we know statically its value. So we know that here inside, in this case, the value is 2. And therefore, we can then recurse into ourselves with a value that is known at method time. And basically, this is base case generation. And with this, I'm at my second last slide. The nice achievement, and this is of course way too small to read, but the nice achievement of this was that within this 160 lines, we encoded a DFT generator, which is highly generic and highly abstract. We abstract over data, we abstract over whether we pre-compute, we abstract over inlining, we abstract over whether we unroll the loops, we abstract over when do we resolve conditionals. We do runtime checks to recurse into base cases, and we specialize functions to have to basically do something like procedure cloning. And that allows us to exactly create a full-fledged FFT implementation. And with this, I want to close off. So what I showed you is a programming approach that is independent of the domain. I talked a lot about the FFT, I know, but it's just such a nice use case. But we did try it also with filters and with sorting and big numbers. And it's combinable, this approach, this pattern is combinable with regular generic programming, which makes it very nice. And it gives the user a user programmable degree for specialization. So that's very different to partial evaluation and these kind of approaches where you hope that the compiler will do it for you. We really want to have that power with the programmer. We think that there's a domain expert that actually has the knowledge when do you unroll and so forth. And so it really gives the power to the programmer. You can express standard loop transformations and transformations in general for performance with it. And finally, I think the artifact is one of the key contributions also of this paper. It's available on my GitHub. It's a very small implementation using just vanilla Scala and actually a second version using Dotti. And I hope you enjoyed the presentation and you got the key idea. And with this, I'm open for questions.